Over 100 Nigerians are on death row in Malaysia. What is the government doing to rescue them? And Amnesty International has launched a report stating that 19 journalists and media practitioners have been persecuted in Nigeria over the first 9 months of this year. This is PLUS Politics, and I am Felicity Ezewuike. You're most welcome to the program. There are more Nigerians than other nationals on death row in Malaysia, Amnesty International has said in a new report. According to the report, of the 568 foreign nationals on death row for various offences in Malaysia, 119 are Nigerians. Nigeria tops the list of foreign nationals with 21%, followed by Indonesia with 16%. We have Iran 15%, India 10%, Philippines 8%, and Thailand about 6%. Is there a reason for this? And what is the Nigerian government doing to rescue these people? Joining me to discuss this are two gentlemen, political analysts, both of them, Sam Adeleke. Pleasure to have you join us.
Good evening.
And of course, our favorite person as well, Martin Lomba. Thank you very much.
Pleasure to be here.
Another report, 119 Nigerians on death row. What is your immediate reaction?
Nigeria again in the news for the wrong reasons. It's sad that we have this report yet again. But it baffles me that these gentlemen and women were able to leave Nigeria's airport and were able to pass through Nigeria's immigration processes without being detected. I work in the tourism industry and I understand what it takes to get a Malaysian visa, Thailand visa, in fact, visa for Asian countries, because you have to write and get a letter of clearance from NDLEA.
Yes.
You have to get police clearance. You have to get enough proof to show that you are actually someone without criminal records. So without even putting much blame on the arrest of Nigerians in bulk in Malaysia, we should be asking the questions, what exactly is wrong with our system here? Is it that we have so many corrupt officials at these borders or at the outpost of this country that we cannot nip it in the bud without these people going and peddling drugs to other countries? So the question should start from Nigeria. What is wrong with NDLEA? What is wrong with that clearance process at the airports? Because when we start from there, it will help to really put it into perspective. That's one. Second is Nigerians that have been caught, because apparently from these statistics, they are the largest in number. They know that they are going to die. So it is not news to them. But these are people who do not care. It's a desperation kind of situation whereby we perish or we'll perish.
We'll get to talk about that in a bit. But let's bring Martins in. What is your reaction to this? This is not the first time. A few months ago, we heard of Nigerian drug traffickers leading Africa in that illicit trade and all of that. Now this.
Nigeria is a big country in every respect. So to that extent, the ratio of Nigerians that can get into trouble or that may get into trouble, the numbers will usually be relatively bigger than some of these smaller countries. But I think that the system in Nigeria has actually broken down. It calls for emergency, and to that extent, it will appear that back home here in Nigeria, we're actually not serious. Because if we were serious, I do not know who will leave a comfortable place to go and face maybe death penalty and go and face all of the hardship. If you actually get to know what some of our people pass through in order to go to these foreign lands, you will be really shocked. It will actually tell you the story that the situation is actually very dire.
But why they know the consequences? That is the question that he was trying to address when I interrupted him. Why do they take that journey, knowing fully that if they get caught, they die? Why?
In Nigeria...
Is desperation enough reason, really?
No, you have to understand that in Nigeria here, a number of people are actually walking dead, to put it that way. We must be very sincere about these things. True. And the reality is that if you check most people, their phones, most of the messages you find is, brother, even if it's 1,000, brother, even if you can just buy me breakfast. Look, we're in deep mess here. And the thing is, when you're in Nigeria, you're not really living. So if you go out there and take all of the risk, whether you want to go through the Atlantic Ocean, whether you want to take, like those chaps that try to follow planes that even maybe go by sea, take all kinds of risks. Because here, the situation is not really enticing.
But we are not a poor country.
Really?
We are not a poor country. We have people that are living flamboyantly. We're just having a light conversation.
So, of people who are living flamboyantly is so minute to the larger population of those who are suffering in abject poverty. We are the number of Nigerians living below the dollar is massive and mind-boggling. The amount of people that spend less than 1,000 naira, 500 naira on food, and this food is not balanced diet. It is a mix of 100 naira, 150, 200, and people are not even, see, the quality of living is so low. People do not sleep well, people do not think well, people do not even drink well. People are also stressed up by traffic, and also by the pressure from tax. So the multiplication of different factors of the Nigerian state has made the quality of living and the standard of life so low that people are desperate to just jet out, like get out. So whatever I need to do, wherever I need to go, even if I have to do it at the expense of my life, I will have to leave. So until we address the fundamentals of what makes a person to be a proper human being, that dignifying factor that makes you live normally, if that is addressed, then people going and peddling drugs at the expense of their life will be drastically reduced.
The situation is not peculiar to Malaysia. We know it's like you alluded to earlier, it cuts across most of these Asian countries,
Philippines,
Thailand, and the rest of them. But what really can the Nigerian government do, knowing that these are adults who are in full understanding of the repercussions of their actions? What more can the government do, really?
I think that fundamentally, we're not addressing the economic downturn of Nigeria. To a large extent, even if the books say that we have gone out of recession, the quality of life is in deep recession. If care is not taken, we may actually be in depression already. And what I mean is that if you look at the way the exchange rate, you know, just took flight from after the elections in 2015, by the time the new government came in, you all were here. We're all living witnesses to how the exchange rate just became something else. The dollar rose to about 500 naira to $1. Mm-hmm. To that extent, you know, it becomes very attractive to leave Nigeria. It is now more attractive to earn a dollar than to earn naira. That is on the one hand. Then the second thing is that the quality of governance is so shabby, so nasty, you know, that even when you go to a foreign country, for you to get assistance from your own embassy is a challenge. You want to have your passport, you know, maybe your visa ran out or maybe your passport expired, so to say, and you needed to renew. You know, the stories are simply very, very ridiculous, very, very embarrassing. So first things first, I think that we need to address our economic reality fundamentally. And I also think that the government of the day, sorry to say, they appear not to have a clue.
They're working, and let's look at what is on the ground. That they have signed an MOU with some of these countries. You know, Thailand. Which other country do we have here?
Philippines.
The Philippines. They've signed with Brazil and some other nations that these people cannot come through to their country without clearing them. Like you mentioned earlier, from the NDLEA.
NDLEA clearance.
Yes, and they went as far. They were so worried about the influx of Nigerians that they went to tell our embassy and our government that there is no job for people coming from Nigeria to Malaysia, so they should make their people aware of that. But this note doesn't seem to be working.
So interestingly, when such international diplomatic drama happens and the signing is done on the screens and just for the public to see. But it doesn't trickle down to that NDLEA officer who approves that letter because he's being bribed and tipped by somebody who is peddling drugs. So until we trickle down governance and accountability to the lowest person on the rung of the ladder, you know, to the most basic officer who attends to the day-to-day approval of these letters, then we'll keep having this, you know, smoke screen that looks like something that was indeed nothing is happening. It's just drama. It's just diplomatic ulabalu, if you ask me.
You're laughing.
Because no, we know these realities. It's clear. And this thing should even be traced. So, for example, you have 21 people caught. When did they enter Malaysia? At what point did they leave Nigeria? Who approved it? With data, these things can be traced. So it's not rocket science.
What is stopping us?
You know something? I think that fundamentally, we need to have some kind of discussion about the direction that Nigeria wants to go. Because in a few years from now, I see doom, a very bleak future if we continue like this. You cannot solve a 20 naira problem with a 10 naira income. It is impossible. Again, I also know that before now, like the late Odumegbu Ojukwu said, he said when he was younger, he understood that you could go with a pocket full of money to buy a basket full of goods. Mm. But lately, at least before he passed on, that it was now a matter of taking a basket full of money to buy a pocket not really full of goods. You understand? Now, to that extent, it tells you that something is fundamentally wrong. When you talk about adjustment, when you're looking for balance, the truth is sometimes, if you look at how things are weighed, you put maybe 1 gram here, you put a few there, you're trying to ensure that this thing balances. The way it is in Nigeria now, everybody is just laying weight on one side, and it is impossible for you to get balance. And I think that until we address that problem, things are likely going to get worse. For instance, you talk about salary issue now. Okay, legislation has been made for minimum wage. They are now talking about adjustments, you know, within the strata of income. Are you with me? And now we're stuck. There's supposed to maybe be a strike tomorrow. Let me advise this country. We need to rework our economics. Otherwise, our currency is just going to be tissue paper. And people will always leave this country. As I speak to you, my mother is not lettered, but I must tell you that she has run away. It is that serious.
Wow.
Yes, it is that serious.
I can imagine
so
how
we need
she
to
is.
We need to take these things very seriously. And I think that if we start from the economic, you see, economics is a bit tricky. And I need all the professors to go back again to start from the basic. What is the basic? Is the study of human behavior. That is where you start from. What is the behavior of Nigerians today with regards to economics? It's corruption everywhere. The school system is so bad, you know the latest. The domestic, there's no difference. Everybody's trying to cut corners because to meet up, to live qualitatively, not even qualitatively, just to get by, your income cannot take you there.
But this issue of debt penalty, all human rights organizations, even the UN has said countries should abolish the debt penalty. And the same all doesn't seem to be lost, according to reports that we're getting, that the Malaysian government is considering abolishing the debt penalty in their country. The law minister in that country, I think, is proposing March 2020. Do you see this maybe as a ray of hope for these people who are on debt row, that there is a possibility this law will come into force before their time of execution?
Well, one can only hope for the best, to be honest. This is a country that has laws, and they can also choose to change the law, to repeal the law, and to adjust the law. To be honest, I like the fact also that the executive director of the Amnesty International Malaysia is the one calling for the abolishment of the death penalty, because if it's coming from Nigeria only, then it's like, oh, okay, because we have interest, but it's coming from somebody over there, it simply shows that something is wrong. Because if you keep doing the same thing over and over again and keep getting, you know, the same result, then why not change? You know, so probably they should abolish it for 5 years and see if the trend will change. And then when people are being convicted and sentenced to life, you know, the correctional measures that come afterwards will probably help to deter those who might want to try it again. So I think we should go through it and let's see what will come out of it, if it's abolished.
I'm going to go to the diplomacy question, but something you said now just triggered my thoughts. If we have a death penalty and people are still trafficking drugs, knowing that they will die if they get caught, and then you want to abolish the death penalty, wouldn't that be a free way for everyone?
Now, there are two ways to look at this issue. One is that, what does the death penalty actually do for the system? The system now, you know, what it does is that it reduces cost. You know, if you imprison someone, maybe life sentence, and the person chooses to live for another 50, 60 years, it's going to be at your expense. Now, if you kill him, chances are the cost of burying will be probably maybe 10% at the most of that life sentence. So that is on the one hand. Then on the second hand, the severity of the crime, you know, is such that if you tolerate it with kid gloves, so to say, the rot will now cut across. The influence will be so negative, the decay will be so overwhelming, and at some point you may not be able to manage the crisis. So that is why most countries, most systems go for the death penalty. Now, on the converse side, the reality is that human life is actually the highest in the spectrum of all living beings. Now, to that extent, human life must be dignified. It must be above the pedestrian. So if we want to go, you know, spiritual, so to say, human life is sacred. Human life is very deep, is deeper than the surface. So when you keep a man alive, chances are you give him the opportunity to understand the other dimensions to his existence, the spiritual side of it, the correctional side to it, the principles that probably he didn't understand before he committed the crime. So to that extent, the quality of life becomes better. Prisoners can even come out sometime and begin to interact, and before you know, the quality of society will be much better. But weighing the two side by side and looking at the reality of human wants, human needs, and the global challenge for survival, it will not be an easy task to, you know, abolish the death penalty.
Because can I even add that some might even consider the fact that, oh, now that we won't be killed anymore, at least I'll be sentenced to life imprisonment and I'll be enjoying free food and a good life in Malaysia prisons. You know, so it's a very dicey decision to make. And we hope that they make the best decision.
Well, your argument about the sacredness of life is, I mean, an important one to consider. And I guess that's why the United Nations and other bodies are saying that we need to make sure that we abolish the death penalty. But come to think of it, we already know that this is the penalty as of now for the crimes that you commit when you go to this country, when it has to do with trafficking, robbery. Let's not forget that it's not just drug trafficking. Some of them get into armed robbery and all of that, inciting violence and issues like that.
Crimes also.
Are we exploring the value of diplomacy in this instance? We have the Diaspora Commission. Abike Dabiri is always in the forefront talking about what she's doing to help people in diaspora, especially those that are in trouble. Are we exploring that as well as we should?
I think that basically, you know, we must admit that the quality of the Nigerian state is probably what is giving Nigerians outside of our shores the kind of treatment that they are getting. I remember a story that my mom told that they were transiting maybe through Germany or something. And at some point, they separated. There was segregation amongst the passengers, you know, that were going to be left behind. They missed their flight or whatever. Now, what happened was that they, as Americans, so to say, they were taken to a hotel to pass the night. and everybody else was left to take care of himself or herself. They are left to sleep at the airport. What am I saying? Now, there are possibilities diplomatically such that if they know that this country has integrity, they can even ratify prisoner exchange, so to say. Yes, we've caught Nigerians. We don't want to spend our resources looking after them. You say we shouldn't kill them. Well, come and carry your people. Now, if they have respect for Nigeria, it is very possible to earn that kind of, you know, concession. But because even within Nigeria, prisoners are complaining. You know, I can assure you that there are many prisoners, if they tell them, you know what, your country has asked that we should ship you back, and then they will say, no, what? No. I might just as well go for the death penalty. Why? You know, the last Minister of Internal Affairs, I can't remember the exact figure, he said that prisoners were being fed daily with maybe about 30,000 naira. And everybody was like, with the beans that is so watery, is that supposed to be a joke or what? So
no,
I think these issues are possible. If the government comes alive, if the government earns the respect that it is supposed to earn, if we're able to arrest the decay within Nigeria here, you discover that even when some of these things are not written laws, countries will be willing to give us concession because of the integrity of our own leadership, so to say.
So how there's a lot of factors come into play. We know the government angle, we know the one of international communities, but what about us as a people? Is it maybe the lifestyle that we live today that is encouraging young people to put themselves at risk? Do I either get it or I die trying, you know? Is there something inherently wrong with our values as a people that is encouraging this mass, you know, misbehavior?
For me, I'd like to disagree that it is the fault of the people. No. Now, there's this narrative that goes around in Nigeria.
No, I didn't say it's the fault. I said, is there something?
Because we keep saying that the followership and it is Nigerians that we should talk to ourselves. No. I've traveled quite a bit and I understand the fact that humans are the same all over the place. Even skin color is just skin color. The same blood runs through everyone. Human behavior is constant across board if they are led by a good leader. And there's accountability, there is justice, there's equity, there is rule of law, societies will grow. So if we do not have good leaders who are visionary, who lead by example, who do not ban things that you are bypassing for yourself, you know, so those are things that we need to look at first. Because if we have a system in which the leadership is functional, I tell you, followership will naturally adjust. Because it is not the fault of the people. People are only trying to survive. It's survival instincts.
Your reoccurring thought here is there's so much more that the government can do.
A lot.
Your final thoughts on this subject?
Well, to flow from the last statement he made, I think that realistically, my understanding, because Nigeria is a great country in terms of endowments, but because we have chosen not to talk about the real issues, we have found ourselves stuck. One of the real issues, for instance, is that you say to a person, you know, even though your jam score is 250, you cannot really enter. But somebody, by quota, by whatever, can enter with a 10% score. For goodness sake, what are we talking about? If everybody must burn the midnight oil in order to write an exam and pass, nobody should be given privileges that he cannot earn. That is the crux of the Nigerian debacle.
Thank you very much for sharing your thoughts, gentlemen.
Thank you.
You're not going anywhere yet. We'll be back to you in a bit. And thank you for staying with us so far. We'll go for a short break, and when we return, we'll be speaking on the dangers of journalism in this present administration. Just stay with us.